Hello and welcome to another edition of Monroe Matters. I'm Chris Carasino alongside Representative Maureen Madden. Representative, thank you so much for joining us today.
It is my pleasure to be here. We have a lot of really important things to go over.
A lot of stuff here. The first one, state budget.
Yes.
We have a state budget passed. Had a lot of missed opportunities. You did vote for it. So why don't we kind of go over that real quick?
Sure. So my third budget, and certainly was smoother than my first budget, and then my second budget, where we voted on how much money we were going to spend, and then we waited quite some time to decide how we were going to pay for it. This happened all in the same week, and we got it done before the June 30th deadline. And there were, of course, as you mentioned, some missed opportunities, but certainly a lot to be happy about in this budget. I believe we put $500 million into the Rainy Day Fund. So that's the second consecutive year that we've done that. So we're preparing for the future. And, you know, the economy, you can never judge from year to year how it's going to be. So we're at least prepared for that. $160 million in new money for education. That is certainly not a small thing. The governor asked for $166 million, so that he got $160 was wonderful. And that's spread across basic education funding, special education, new money for Head Start and pre-K. And we added more children to pre-K and Head Start. And every year we've been increasing that number. So that, of course, is important as well, because we know the earlier we get to students, the more successful they're going to be. We added money to career and technical education. We're beginning to see the importance of career and technical education. Not every student wants to go to college. Not every student wants to incur that debt. There are students who go to career and technical schools, and they want to come out as plumbers and electricians and carpenters. And we know that the baby boomer was the largest generation of people who went into CTE and trades. And so they're obviously getting older and they're beginning to retire. So we just really need that new generation of plumbers and electricians and carpenters. And so the focus is just right for putting that emphasis on career and technical education. Healthcare workers are going to see a modest increase for the first time in a very long time. And so I heard from healthcare workers and you know, the unions that represent them, that they were happy with the increase for healthcare workers in this bill. So that was also wonderful. And, you know, constantly we're talking about the opioid epidemic and the need for more investment in human services across the board, and we saw increases in human services. So, you know, that with the historic farm bill, which we'll talk about a little later, there was positive bipartisan work that went into this budget. And I was, you know, not happy that we didn't get everything we wanted. But as I mentioned on my remarks on the floor, budgets are statements of priorities and they're compromises. And I think we achieved both in this budget.
While, like you just said, all those things are very important in it, there were some missed opportunities, some of them being education inequities regarding that and property tax reform.
Sure. And that was something that I mentioned in my remarks. We spend more than 44 other states in education funding, but we are dead last in equity. So very much your funding is tied to your zip code. And what that means is, you know, areas where property values aren't as high and people aren't as wealthy, they get shortchanged. We certainly get shortchanged in Monroe County. I know they get shortchanged in other areas. There are 185 school districts that are funded inequitably, and we need to work harder to catch those 185 school districts up. Because at this rate, if we're not funding education, basic education funding in the numbers we ought to be every single year, I believe when the bill was first passed in 2015, only 7% of the new money was going to fund education, but now we're up to 11%, so that's 4 years That's a percentage point each year, if my math is correct. So at this rate, it could take decades. Mm-hmm. So we need to do something to speed that process up. And also, we need to address property tax reform. There are too many people who are deciding, elderly people deciding between medication or paying their property taxes, or young couples struggling who may still have college debt, who are struggling to pay their property taxes, buying new homes, or some who are looking at the property taxes and not even bothering to buy a home because it is cheaper to rent. So these are the things that we have to address. And of course, the minimum wage at $7.25 an hour is lower than any of the surrounding states. And we know that as the minimum wage goes up, so do the wages, you know, go up of other companies around. You know, mm-hmm. if the minimum wage goes up to $9.50 or $12, companies that are already paying that are more likely to increase. And for every dollar that a working person puts into the economy sees a $1.60 return. So it's, you know, people who are struggling paycheck to paycheck, they're not sitting on that increase. They're using that to buy a car or to buy a television or big ticket items they might not have been able to afford before. So we need to realize that in this legislature, and we need to seriously address raising a minimum wage.
Mm-hmm. And you addressed these things on the House floor. You expressed your frustration. Let's show the viewers at home your remarks.
This is my third budget, and I've become aware of two things, that budgets are statements of priorities and budgets are compromises. And while I'm thrilled to death that we got $160 million for education, I am cognizant of the fact that we rank sixth in the nation for basic education spending, and we rank dead last in equity in education funding. So while we are still adding more money to education, we have ignored the hundreds of people who have filled the Capitol Rotunda pleading for us to have equity in education funding. So while we pass this budget, as we surely will, your education is still directly tied to your zip code.
Something else that came out big with the budget negotiations was the elimination of general assistance. Do you want to talk about that program a little bit?
Sure. The general assistance program is a $200 cash assistance program that is not, by and large, a permanent $200 for the rest of your life. It's a transitional payment that helps maybe women who are leaving abusive domestic mm-hmm. situations, and between the time they leave and the time they either find employment or find a place to live or get settled into their new life, it helps them. It many times goes to disabled vets who are waiting for their disability, or people who are disabled in general, physically, mentally, to help them. Because if you have SNAP assistance, food assistance, that doesn't cover things like diapers, it doesn't cover toiletries, it doesn't cover bus fare. So people who are disabled who don't have a car and have to travel to therapy or travel to appointments on public, you know, mm-hmm. transportation, this helps them with that. It's an integral part of someone's budget, who lives on a fixed income. And so for us to take that away, I spoke with so many of my colleagues on the floor about how disappointed we were that the legislature voted to take that $200 away. And we can listen to my remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise in opposition to HB 33. 1.5 million people in Pennsylvania live in abject poverty. 3.5 million people in Pennsylvania live near poor. That's 5 million poor people out of 12.8 million people in Pennsylvania. When those impoverished people get done paying their rent, they have very little for anything else. So what is $200 a month? It's bus fare. It's toiletries. It's diapers for your baby. It's a host of things that you would not be able to afford without this small sum of money each and every month. Outside of property tax reform, The most feedback I get from my constituents is on the General Assistance Cash Fund. Please, Representative Madden, go to Harrisburg and argue and fight for our $200 a month. So here I am, the 115th District, and all of the people of the Commonwealth fighting for you 5 million poor people who depend on this $200 a month. I would not even presume to tell my colleagues how to vote, except to vote for your vote your conscience. But for me personally, my conscience tells me to vote for this bill would be unconscionable. Thank you.
This is another budget that wasn't too friendly to the environment. Do you want to talk about the impacts that the decisions that were made has on the environment?
Sure. So I mentioned in my clip that I thought this bill was an environmental disaster. And because every year we keep chipping away at the things that protect our environment, we keep losing staff with the Department of Environmental Protection. And when we do that, we don't have enough people staffing to make sure that we do have clean air and clean water, which is so essential. Tourism is our number one or number two, depending upon which committee I'm sitting on. If I'm sitting on ag, it's number one. If I'm sitting on tourism, it's number one. But tourism and agriculture, both things, clean air, clean water, arable land is essential. And so if we keep chipping away at the departments and the agencies that protect our air and water, we're not going to do as good a job as, you know, making sure that we have the best environment. Also, we keep taking that money and using it to fund the rest of the state. Mm-hmm. And we have to stop taking money from one place to fund another place and start looking at ways to generate recurring sustainable revenue. And one thing that was particularly egregious was in one of the fiscal code bills, there was a provision that placed a moratorium on banning plastic for a year. I think all the studies are in. I think we've seen the ocean and with islands of plastic. I think we know that it takes the typical shopping bag that you get at the supermarket 1,000 years to decompose. The research is in, and I'm not sure what the thought process was behind this because it came from the Senate. Mm. But I know that in my community, Stroudsburg Borough was talking, they were talking, having active discussions about banning plastic in the borough. So I was really unhappy about that. And I'm going to start initiatives of promoting using reusable bags. I'm going to order quite a few of them and start giving them out of my office and giving them out at street festivals and things that we do and any you know, events that I go to encourage people to bring a bag with them wherever they go and to think about that 1,000 years that it takes for one of those bags to decompose. And so while we may not be able to create a moratorium, we can all be mindful and we can all make certain changes, small changes in our lives to protect the environment.
So in other words, these hurdles can get in your way. You're going to continue the fight to make sure that the environment is clean, people are protected, and everybody has access to safe and clean drinking water and air.
Absolutely, especially in the Poconos where we are tourism-driven and we are so proud of our exceptional water quality and how beautiful it is just to come to the Poconos.
Switching gears here a little bit, stepping aside from the budget, you had your Women's Expo.
I did.
Why don't you going to tell us how that went?
It went wonderful. We had our third Women's Expo, and again, we had in excess of 50 vendors, people there from healthcare to staffing agencies to Women's Resources, which is an agency that works with women in domestic violence situations. Big Brothers and Big Sisters was there again, and Meals on Wheels. So any state agency geared towards women or geared towards families in general was able to come, and it was a great turnout once again. And I'm just excited to hold it every year because it is a resource that I don't think there are any other like it in our community.
Why don't you tell us why you hold this every year? Why is it so important to you?
It's so important because I don't know that there are, I think it's an opportunity for women to come together. Mm-hmm. Of course, we invite everyone, but it's an opportunity for women to come together and see who are the female artists, who are the female business owners, you know, who are the female realtors in the area, you know, who is driving the economy for women? And that's really when women get a chance to come out and shine. We have authors, we have artists, we have, you know, like I said, realtors, we have midwives that come, you know, who work in conjunction with hospitals. So it's just a really good opportunity for women to come out and see what other women are doing in the community.
You mentioned Meals on Wheels was there. You had the opportunity to speak with somebody from there. Why don't we go ahead and toss to that interview and your conversation with Meals on Wheels.
Stacy, thank you for being here and participating in our third annual Women's Expo. For people who may not know, you know, all that Meals on Wheels does, talk to us a little bit about your program.
Sure, sure. Thank you for having us. We appreciate the opportunity. Monroe County Meals on Wheels delivers meals to residents of Monroe County. The requirement for our program is that they have to be homebound, unable to cook or prepare meals for themselves because of a physical or a mental condition. So we don't have an age requirement. We serve some older adults that, for whatever reason, can't care for themselves. We provide these meals. They're delivered by volunteers Monday through Friday. Not only do we provide the meals, though, we provide a well check on a daily basis to make sure that the client is okay. If a volunteer notices anything amiss or the client doesn't answer the door, we follow the appropriate measures and make sure they're all right. Also, a lot of our clients are homebound with no family, so we provide some social interaction. Sometimes our volunteers are the only people they see each day. In addition, this is the 10th anniversary of our pet program because a lot of our clients, like I said, live alone. And their pets are their only family. It's a reason to get up in the morning. So what we do is we have a program that relies solely on donations. And we provide some pet food once a month. It's, again, delivered by our wonderful volunteers. And it just gives them a little help. We also provide cat litter. And we got a grant a couple of years ago. And we also help with immunizations and well care checks at some of the vets in the area. We're constantly striving to meet whatever needs our clients have. That being said, we're always looking for donations of pet food. You can contact myself at our office if you're interested in holding a pet food drive. In addition, we can always use volunteers to help us deliver the meals. You know, and that can be achieved if you just go on our website or contact our office. We're looking for volunteers that can pick up meals at our office in Stroudsburg or one of our satellite locations in the county for the outlying areas. You deliver from about 10 to 1 or 2 in the afternoon. We give you a sheet to follow so you know the route. You return the empty containers to a location. And you can do this as little as once a month. A lot of people think it has to be an extreme commitment. And you can deliver once a month. You can deliver once a week. You can do a route in your area if you're more comfortable with that. Some volunteers like to see the county, and we'll deliver differently.
So how can people get in touch with you? What is your website? What is the main phone number? Give us your address.
Sure. We're located at 901 Polk Valley Road in Stroudsburg, just right off of Business 209. Our website is www.monroemeals.org, and our phone number is 570-424-8794, and we are there Monday through Friday from 8 to 4, and we'd be happy to answer any questions anyone might have.
Thank you, Stacy. Thank you so much for participating in the expo, and thank you for all that you do in our community.
Getting back here to Harrisburg, there was some bright spots again when it came out of these during the budget negotiation times, some new laws that were enacted, one being a new healthcare exchange program. Do you want to talk about how that will help make healthcare more affordable and help even create jobs?
Sure. So HB 3 passed, and when former President Obama when we passed the Affordable Care Act. Every state had the opportunity to take billions of federal dollars and create their own state exchange. Unfortunately, Pennsylvania was not one of those states, so it was a lost opportunity to create hundreds of thousands of jobs, infuse billions of dollars into the economy, and save consumers millions of dollars. HB3 is predicted to save insurance premiums, save Pennsylvanians over $250 million in insurance premiums. It will widen the exchange. It will give people access to different plans. Mm-hmm. It will create jobs in the state because we will need more people in every aspect of healthcare as we're expanding the program. And like I said, it will save millions of dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars. And the idea that we'll do it, we'll take that federal money and we'll develop our own exchange gives us better control. We have the opportunity to make it more efficient. And I believe that is what former President Obama envisioned when he conceived of the Affordable Care Act and when they passed it. Unfortunately, so few states took the money and to set up the state exchange. But now we're thinking better of it, and we passed this law. And I believe it's supposed to take effect 2021. It will be completely in place, and another way to generate more recurring, sustaining revenue and commerce and jobs and move Pennsylvania forward. I'm extremely happy with the bill.
Why is this so great for Monroe County specifically?
Well, you know, healthcare is just exploding everywhere in the state, and in Monroe County, our former Pocono Medical Center has partnered with Lehigh Valley Hospital. We have St. Luke's. We have urgent cares popping up everywhere. So it's going to bring a better quality and more health care choices to Monroe County. And certainly lowering the premium will just be, you know, extraordinarily helpful for everyone. One of the problems that we hear all the time is that health care, there are not enough options and it's too expensive. And when I ran for office and I knocked on doors, health care was the number one issue here in Pennsylvania. It is the number one issue in the nation. And I'm just happy to see that we are addressing it both on the federal and the state level, that we are addressing the needs of the people. It's what government is supposed to do work for you?
Health care, big issue. Agriculture, a big issue, and very big for Monroe County with all the farms that you guys have. That brings us to the first ever, Pennsylvania's first ever farm bill. Why don't you go and tell us about that?
$23 million investment in farming across the spectrum. We have over 100 farms in Monroe County, so this is big for us. Mm-hmm. As I've reported on previous shows, we have Pocono Raceway, which has begun planting and is poised to be the largest organic farm in Pennsylvania, working with the Rodale Institute. Mm-hmm. They've instituted and built a home for veterans. And this $23 million investment in agriculture is going to do many of the same things. There's going to be an investment in veterans. There's going to be an investment in organic farming because the governor has stated that he would like Pennsylvania to be the leader in organic farming. So it's going to create opportunities. It's going to strengthen farming because, you know, farmers have a tough time. We heard during a policy mm-hmm. hearing with Secretary Redding of Agriculture that the climate change is affecting farmers, that we're seeing that it's getting warmer, and things that used to grow in Virginia are now growing in Pennsylvania. So that's going to be a switch. Another big thing is we're going to be able to grow hemp now mm-hmm. in the state of Pennsylvania, and hemp used hemp body lotion this morning. Hemp is good for so many things. Mm-hmm. And that will be a real boom. And then as we talk about, have a serious conversation about the legalization of adult recreational cannabis, where do the farmers, if that happens, where's their place in that farming as well? So it was a great bill. Both sides came together again in a bipartisan way with the governor, and it's moving forward. It's just going to be a great investment for the state of Pennsylvania.
Speaking of a great investment, you guys now have a women's military museum that just opened up in Mount Pocono. Very big for your area. Want to tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. So the Women's Military Museum and services, military services for families, was the idea of retired Sergeant Major Claudette Williams, who served her country for 30 years, did multiple tours, and she, when she retired, she achieved the rank of Sergeant Major. Only 1% of women ever achieve that rank, and women of color, it's much less. And so this was an idea that she put out into the community, and then actually people from all over the country started saying, well, I have this and I have that. And I actually had a book of a photographer who worked during wartime, World War II, and started taking pictures within Arlington National Cemetery. And I had that signed copy that I donated to the museum. So people are bringing things from everywhere. And it's really quite a remarkable little museum and a wonderful project. And I was happy to go there and take a look and talk with retired Sergeant Major Claudette Williams.
Well, let's actually take you to the interview with the creator of this great museum.
We're here today in Mount Pocono, Pennsylvania, speaking with retired Sergeant Major and Borough Councilwoman Claudette Williams at the occasion of the opening of the Women's Military Museum. Talk to me about this idea and how you made it happen and how it was inspired.
So this, from conception to birth, this museum actually took about 5 months. And I think it took that amount of time because of my passion. My oldest daughter was with me when I picked up the first piece, and I said this was going to be for a museum that I'm going to, idea that I have. And she thought that I was just picking up junk pieces, like, oh, Mom, really? Again? You know, but I took it, and the idea was there in my head, and it took about 5 months. And one of the reasons for this is too often that I've gone somewhere and I've given my idea, and they look at it and they go, so where did your husband serve? You know, and I'm like, no, this not my husband, me. You know, and then I realized that women veterans are not being given credit for their service to this country. And so this museum is about showing what different women across a different time frame, and also to educate the public on women veterans.
Claudette, what branch of the service did you serve? How long did you serve? How many tours did you do? And tell us a little bit about your service.
So I served United States Army 30 years. I served two tours overseas, one during Operation Enduring Freedom, Operation Iraqi Freedom. I went over in Operation New Dawn. My unit was in Bahrain, but of course my areas of command were Afghanistan, Iraq, Oman region, in the Salalah area, Qatar, all over the Southwest Asia, and I had soldiers spread out all over those areas, and it was an honor, a complete honor to serve my country. It's a sacrifice, you know, because at the time of my service, I'm a single mom, and when my first tour overseas, I have a set of twins and an older daughter at the time, and when I left, my twins were 7, and when I came back, they were 9, you know, so it was quite a sacrifice, but if I had to do it again, I would definitely do it again to serve my country.
So when we go inside, Claudette, what types of artifacts are we going to see? Are they generational? Where did they come from?
The artifacts in the museum are all donated. Some of it are my stuff, you know, from my different time in service. And our treasured pieces, or we have a uniform from a WAVE officer back in 1943. You'll see that on the wall, and it's a whole big write-up. And that is actually from one of our a young lady from the West End, Teresa Daly. Her mom wore that uniform, Navy uniform. We have foot lockers and stuff like that from way before, in the early 60s or before the 60s. It's books, it's awards, it's ribbons, it's you name it.
Well, we thank you for your sacrifice, we thank you for your service, and we thank you for this museum.
We got a little bit of time left. Why don't you tell us what you're doing with the remainder of your summer?
Well, my staff and I are going to be out into the community, and we're going to be knocking on doors, and we're going to be distributing our newsletter, which is coming out in the beginning of August, and we're going to be handing out some information on Real ID and other things that we think are important to my constituents, and just let them know that we're here, and they can contact us anytime.
Well, Representative, thank you so much for keeping us updated with the budget, things happening in the district. And thank you all there at home for watching today's episode of Monroe Matters. Until next time, I'm Chris Caracino, along with Representative Maureen Madden. Have a good day.